cut him from this source of peace are the impurities of the mind. Lust, greed and wrath have thrown a mantle of darkness over the radiant spirit of peace within. Before the light and power of the truth can become manifest in man, the mind must be freed from the draws of violent passions and proud ambitions. This can be done only through concentration, meditation, and self-surrender. The mind will then be ever bathing in tranquility, and the physical movements will automatically be attuned to the inner spirit of peace and freedom. When peace reigns in the mind, the thought arising from it shall possess infinite potency. Such a thought can work through time and space without being affected by their limitations. It can awaken the heart of every human being, nay, of every creature, to the consciousness of peace. Just as the turmoil of the heart is transmitted to another by a subtle and inner process, so also the peace of one individual can mysteriously influence and transform the most troubled heart of the other. There are and there were great men of peace, and we know all those who came to see them and hear their message were delivered of their mental obsessions and became settled in peace. The world as we find it at present is full of discord and is eagerly aspiring for peace and harmony. To be at peace with all, a person must, in the first place, realize the spirit of peace within himself. Peace denotes a feeling of unity and oneness with all people on the earth. This unity of oneness can be possible only through the recognition of the immortal spirit that permeates the hearts of all beings. The preliminary step toward the attainment of universal peace through the realization of the Supreme Spirit or God is to cultivate goodwill and friendliness towards all people alike. Here we have to transcend our petty and narrow ideals of life, destroy the sense of our aloofness from the rest of humanity, and work and toil for the common weal and uplift of our fellow men without any distinction of race, nationality, color and creed. The foregoing exposition gives a fairly comprehensive definition of the term peace thought. Peace thought is not a thought conditioned by narrow personal aims or born of individualism, but it is a wide and all-embracing consciousness. It envelops in its sweep all creatures and beings of the world. Such a thought, arising as it does from the omnipotent spirit, is pregnant with infinite power to work for the regeneration of mankind and establish the rule of peace on this aching earth. The power to wound and kill and the power to heal and save are both in man. It is the thought that makes him do the one or the other. The thought imbued with hate and violence produces the first result, and the thought imbued with the love and peace serves to bring about the second. Thought can contaminate or purify according to its nature. We know now, if we create within us peace thought, what it is capable of achieving, it can not only, as far as the individual is concerned, merge him in the supreme peace, but can also create a like thought in another and grant him the same experience. If thus this powerful thought of peace possesses like a current from mind to mind and spreads throughout the world, it can generate a most potent world conscious of peace. By this consciousness, the war mentality that prevails amongst only a minor part of humanity can be subdued, if not transmuted. This is no doubt a colossal achievement, but nothing short of this could dispel the ominous clouds of war that are hanging over us all. Real and lasting harmony and peace can become a possibility when mankind realizes the close affinity and fellowship of its members from the standpoint of the universal spirit, not from the individual level. World union and harmony have been held by those who either deny the all-powerful spirit dwelling in each one of us or do not believe in its wonderful powers to be an impossibility. If we turn to account the powers of the spiritual realm, there is nothing impossible for us to attain. We can then avert the greatest wars, calamities, catastrophes that befall humanity. What is needed is that we should in the first place believe in such a realm of power and light, and then earnestly seek for it, and lastly, having entered it, use all its forces for bringing down peace and goodwill on the earth. Working merely on the mental and physical surface for creating a peace consciousness is not sufficient. The peace thought must start from the silence of the spirit and act with an irresistible power to encompass all who come within its purview and thereby fill the very atmosphere with the thrills of peace. There are all over the world great yogis, rishis, saints, self-illumined men who, without physically coming in the front for helping the aspiring humanity to evolve toward the universal fellowship, are still on the thought plane, silently using their spiritual power to bring about this great consummation. But for them, the world would be a pandemonium, wherein men would have behaved worse than the beasts of the jungle, tearing up and destroying each other wholesale. This demonic nature in man is greatly kept down by the spiritual power wielded by these powerful spiritual masters. The messages of peace and goodwill have come down to us through a long line of saints, sages, teachers from time immemorial. Let us all who long for peace in this world join our hearts in the prayer that their voices may shake us up to the awareness of the untold possibilities that lie hidden within us for forming a consciousness of peace and harmony in the world. If we start applying our mind on the theme elucidated by Papa, it zeroes to one. Unless and until we make a conscious move from me to we, and we to him, the great provider, peace is a distinct reality. Peace is a distant reality. When he said about impurities, all the impurities stem from the me and mine. And this me and mine can be erased only by observing and later on experiencing. God gives us umpteen number of opportunities to witness, to observe. Many, many acts of virtues around us, not only from human beings, but from every creation. If only we are blessed with the mindset to observe, then we will find that slowly the peace dimension is becoming more and more clearer and clearer. Along with this philosophy, we thought it would be better if we also try to go through some of the episodes. Here is one narration by our great friend, Sri Subrata Bakshi, the Chief Operating Officer of Mindtree Consulting. In one of his messages to the IIM, Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, somewhere in 2004, he made this presentation. Later on, somebody was kind enough to send it through email to us, which is so touching. The different facets of this, you know, piece is touched through episodes. It is not mere dry philosophy. Later on, we happened to talk to him over phone and told him that this article is a source of inspiration for us, and we use it in many, many forums. So with our grateful acknowledgement to him, we again present it to you all. He says, "I was the last child of a small-time government servant, a family of five brothers. My earliest memory of my father is as that of a district employment officer in Koraput, Orissa. Koraput was and remains as back of beyond as you can imagine. There was no electricity, no primary school nearby, water did not flow out of a tap. As a result, I did not go to school until the age of 8. I was homeschooled. My father used to get transferred every year. The family belonging fit into the back of a jeep, so the family moved from place to place, and without any trouble, my mother would set up an establishment and get us going." The whole household articles can be packed in a backside of the jeep. So simple life, you know, need-based life. That is the first sign of peace. Raised by a widow who had come as a refugee from the then East Bengal, she was a matriculate when she married my father. My parents set the foundation of my life and the value system which makes me what I am today and largely defines what success means to me today. As district employment officer, my father was given a jeep by the government. There was no garage in the office, so the jeep was parked at our house. My father refused to use it to commute to the office. He told us that the jeep was an expensive resource given by the government. He reiterated to us that it was not his jeep, but the government's jeep, insisting that he would use it only to tour the interiors. He would walk to his office on normal days. He also made sure that we never sat in the government jeep. We could sit in only when it was stationary. That was our early childhood lessons in governance, a lesson that corporate managers learn that hard way, some never do. Conscientiousness. We are trying to understand peace. With that dimension, we are hearing this. The driver of the jeep was treated with respect due to any other member of my father's office. As small children, we were taught not to call him by his name. We had to use the suffix Dada whenever we were made to refer to him in public or private. When I grew up to own a car, and a driver by the name Raju was appointed, I repeated the lesson to my two small daughters. They have, as a result, grown up to call Raju, Raju uncle. Very different from many of their friends who refer to their family drivers as my driver. When I hear that term from a school or a college-going person, I cringe. To me, the lesson was significant. You treat small people with more respect than how you treat big people. It is more important to respect your subordinates than your superiors. Our day used to start with the family huddling around my mother's chula, an earthen fireplace. She would build at each place for posting where she would cook for the family. There was no gas, no electricity stove. The morning routine started with tea. As the brew was served, Father would ask us to read about the editorial page of the Statesman's Mufassil edition, delivered one day late. We did not understand much of what we were reading, but the ritual was meant for us to know that the world was larger than Koraput district and the English I speak today, despite having studied in an Oriya medium school, has to do with the routine. After reading the paper aloud, we were told to fold it neatly. Father taught us a simple lesson. He used to say, "You should leave your newspaper and your toilet the way you expect to find it." That lesson was about showing consideration to others. Business begins and ends with this simple precept. Quality, care and concern for others. No? We are trying to understand peace. How to uncover the peace that is within us. Being small children, we were also enamored with advertisement in the newspaper for transistor radios. We did not have one. We saw other people having radios in their homes. And each time there was an advertisement for Philips, Murphy or Bush, we would ask Father when we could get one. Each time my father would reply that we did not need one because he already had 5 radios, alluding to his 5 sons. We also did not have a house of our own and would occasionally ask Father as to when, like others, we would live in our own house. He would have given us a similar reply, "We do not need a house of our own. I already own 5 houses." His replies did not gladden our hearts. Nonetheless, we learned that it is important not to measure success and sense of well-being through material possessions. Because the father was calm, contented, equanimous, pious, you know. Nothing had disturbed him. Government houses seldom came with fences. Mother and I collected twigs and built a small fence. After lunch, my mother would never sleep. She would take her kitchen utensils, and with those, she and I would dig the rocky, white ant infested surrounding. We planted flowering bushes. The white ants destroyed them. My mother brought ash from her chula, mixed it in the earth, and then we planted the seedlings all over again. This time they bloomed. At that time, my father's transfer order came. A few neighbors asked my mother why she was taking so much pain to beautify a government house, why she was planting seeds that would only benefit the next occupant. My mother replied that it did not matter to her that she would not see the flowers in bloom. She said, "I have to create a bloom in a desert, and whenever I am given a new place, I must leave it more beautiful than what I had inherited." That was my first lesson in success. It was about what you create. It is not what you create for yourself. It is what you leave behind that defines success. Just keep on thinking about it. All these episodes, you know, when we take it very seriously, it throws us the gateway to peace within us. Quality care and concern for others. Less and less of me and mine, more and more of we and us. My mother began developing cataract in her eyes when I was very small. At that time, the eldest among my brothers got a teaching job at the University of Bhubaneswar and had to prepare for the civil service exams. So it was decided that my mother would have to cook for him, and as her appendage, I had to move too. For the first time in my life, I saw electricity in homes, water coming out of a trap, out of a tap. It was around 1965, and the country was going to war with Pakistan. My mother was having problem reading, and in any case, being Bengali, she did not know the Oriya script. So in addition to my daily chorus, my job was to read her the local newspaper, end to end. That created in me a sense of connectedness with a larger world. I began taking interest in many different things. While reading out news about the war, I felt that I was fighting the war myself. She and I discussed the daily news, built a bond with the larger universe. In it we became a part of a larger reality. Till date, I measure my success in terms of the sense of larger connectedness. Over the next few years, my mother's eyesight dimmed, but in me, she created a larger vision. A vision with which I could continue to see the world. And I sensed through my eyes, she was seeing too. As the next few years unfolded, her vision deteriorated and she was operated for cataract. I remember when she returned after her operation and she saw my face clearly for the first time. She was astonished. She said, "Oh my God, I did not know you were so fair." I remain mighty pleased with that adulation even till today. Within weeks of getting her eyesight back, she developed a corneal ulcer and overnight became blind in both eyes. That was in 1969. She died in 2002. In all those 32 years of living with blindness, she never complained about her fate even once. Curious to know what she saw with blind eyes, I asked her once if she sees darkness. She replied, "No, I do not see darkness. I only see light even with my eyes closed." Until she was 80 years of age, she did her morning yoga every day, swept her own room, washed her own clothes. To me, success is about the sense of independence. It is about not seeing the world, but seeing the light. Another dimension is no complaints, no grumblings, contented in the condition in which we are placed. We are trying to understand the gateway to peace. Over the many intervening years, I grew up, studied, joined the industry, and began to carve my life's own journey. I began my life as a clerk in a government office, went on to become a management trainee with the DCM group, eventually found my life's calling with the IT industry when fourth generation computers came to India in 1981. Life took me places. I worked with outstanding people, challenging assignments, and traveled all over the world. In 1992, while I was posted in US, I learned that my father, living a retired life with my eldest brother, had suffered a third-degree burn injury and was admitted in the Safdarjung Hospital in Delhi. I flew back to attend to him. He remained for a few days in critical stage, bandaged from neck to toe. The Safdarjung Hospital, on those days probably, was a cockroach-infested, dirty, inhuman place. The overworked, under-resourced sisters in the burn ward were both victims and perpetrators of dehumanized life at its worst. One morning, while attending to my father, I realized that the blood bottle was empty, and fearing that air would go into his vein, I asked the attending nurse to change. She bluntly told me to do it by myself. In that horrible theater of death, I was in pain, frustration, anger. Finally, when she relented and came, this is the most touching part. My father opened his eyes and murmured to her, "Why have you not gone home yet?" Here was a man on his deathbed, but more concerned about the overworked nurse than his own state. I was stunned at his stoic self. There I learned that there was no limit to how concerned you can be for another human being, and what is the limit of inclusion you can create. My father died the next day. He was a man whose success was defined by his principles, his frugality, his universalism, his sense of inclusion. Above all, he taught me, success is your ability to rise above your discomfort, whatever may be your current state. You can, if you want, raise your consciousness above your immediate surroundings. Success is not about building material comforts, the transistor that he could never buy, the house that he never owned. His success was about the legacy he left, the mimetic continuity of his ideals that grew beyond the smallness of an ill-paid, unrecognized government service world. Last 2 years back, at the age of 82, mother had a paralytic stroke and was lying in a government hospital in Bhubaneswar. I flew down from the US, where I was serving my second stint, to see her. I spent 2 weeks with her in the hospital as she remained in a paralytic state. She was neither getting better nor moving on. Eventually, I had to return to work. While leaving her behind, I kissed her face. In that paralytic state and in a garbled voice, she said, "Why are you kissing me? Go and kiss the world." Her river was nearing its journey. At the confluence of life and death, this woman, who came to India as a refugee, raised by a widowed mother, no more educated than high school, married to an anonymous government servant whose last salary was rupees 300, robbed of her eyesight by fate and crowned by adversity, was telling me to go and kiss the world. So when we think about peace, we find all these characters were building up their life on peace only. That is why they all remain unshaken, unruffled, unaffected. So by hearing such anecdotes, by trying to put it in our own way, in our own life, probably we might also get the key for our gateway to peace. More about it tomorrow. Thank you very much. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram.